Hello students. We are going to start today the next session of Science and Technology part 2. Science and Technology 2. The first chapter was Heredity and Evolution. And we are going to cover page 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. Today we will be having a session 4. Of 3 we have already seen and we are going to the evolution part. We have already covered heredity and then we'll discuss the evolution. Now, what is evolution? Evolution is like a formation of new species due to changes in specific characters. Formation of a new species, how new species is going to form? Because there will be changes of a specific character of several generations. It will not change immediately, but during several generations it is going to change in living organism, and as it is, how it is going to change, why it is going to change, it is because it is responding to a natural selection, and that is called evolution. So in simple terms and in a straightforward way, you can say that formation of a new species due to change in specific characters of several generations of living organism as a response to natural selection is called evolution. I hope you understood. Evolution is a very important part because it gives a new species, and that is how we are also formed in this, on this earth. We were not earlier before. So let us understand evolution one by one and how it has started when there was nothing on the earth. So there was no life on the earth around 3.5 billion years ago. 3.5 billion means 1 billion is 100 crores. So that means 350 crores years before there was nothing on the earth. So what was there at that moment? There were simple elements. They were found in ocean in the beginning. So in the beginning, what were there? Only elements, simple elements were found in the ocean. Now these simple elements, they turned slowly into simple inorganic and organic compounds. So these elements are responsible for formation of organic and inorganic compounds. So that was a second step that also took a long time. Then after simple organic and inorganic compounds, there were complex compounds. Like, what are the complex compounds? There are proteins, nucleic acids, and they are all found in the same area where simple organic and inorganic compounds were there. So proteins and nucleic acids, they are found, which took long period. It took long period to make the proteins and nucleic acid from complex compounds. I hope you understand that. So what was there earlier? Simple elements, they are found in ocean. Then simple organic and inorganic compounds in the ocean itself. Then these organic and inorganic compounds, simple one, they formed complex compounds like proteins and nucleic acids. And then from these nucleic acids and proteins, the first primitive cell might have formed or may have formed from these mixtures of different organic and inorganic. So the first primitive cell, which was a living cell, may have been formed from the mixture of different organic and inorganic compounds. Okay, now these are the cells. So there will be so many cells. So many millions of cells might have formed. So out of those cells, the number of cells increased. Number of cells, like one cell has formed, then second cell has formed, then third cell has formed. So from these number of cells increased using surrounding chemicals. So whatever chemicals were present in the surrounding, their number of the cells might have increased. So then what happened? See, if there are so many cells, what will happen? If there are so many people and limited resources are available, food is limited, then what will happen? Actually, good, healthy and only fit, those who are fit. Fit means strong. Good, healthy and only fittest cell adjusted with the surrounding. So the cells which were good, the cells which were healthy, the cells which were fit to adjust the surrounding, yani atmospheric, whatever the surrounding atmosphere, surrounding ecosystem were present, the fit cell were survived and the other cells were perished or died. So, it is in a simple terms, if you are fit, you can survive. Like we can understand, like in this pandemic, you might have seen the people who are susceptible, who are not fit, who have some problem with a health problem, they are getting infected very quickly than the people who are healthy. Those who are not having any kind of ailment, any kind of sickness or disease. So, that is why we always say they are immune. Immune to various conditions, or they can adjust with the various conditions. Okay, I hope you understand this particular slide. Then, now the cells were formed, then the cells, those cells which are fit, they survived. So, what happened? So, these cells, a single cell, they make so many double cell, quadruplet cells. So, these cells, they turn into organs. Those organs turn into tissues and those tissues turn into different animal. Now you can see on the earth there are huge diversity of animals and plants are found, and these animals and plants, they have simple as well as complex characters. Simple means a unicellular animal which is only having a one cell, and complex characters means having a different millions of cells together, and they make a different complex characters such as different types of animals. Now you can observe in the surrounding animal diversity, which is diversity means diversions means there are so many different kinds which having morphological diversity, which is having different kind of diversity, behavioral diversity, there are so many diversities. So they range from unicellular, which is unicellular animals such as amoeba, paramecium, to multicellular and complex animal such as human, such as we are a human being, we are a complex animal, and like a giant whale, see, it's not a fish, it's a whale, is a mammal because it has got a mammary gland. Okay, so similarly, like animal diversity, we have got plant diversity as well. And plant diversity also ranges from unicellular plant like chlorella to multicellular plant like banyan tree. So, I hope you, you got the point. So, diversity of the animal and plants are available on the earth, and these life exist on the earth from equator to both the poles. Equator means zero, from the both the poles mean north and south pole, and in between there is a 0 degree now line, so that is called equator. So they are available from north pole to south pole as well as on equator, means everywhere they are available. So these animals, they are available. Where they are available? They are available, they are present everywhere, like in the air, water, earth, rocks and soil, etc. So wherever you name it, the organisms are there. There is a lot of diversity. You will find animals diversity everywhere. You will find plant diversity everywhere. So, I hope you understand what is the diversity. Now, we will go for the next part. What is the theory of evolution? So, how this evolution occurred? So, what is the theory behind this? So, we'll see the theory of evolution is a progressive development of plant and animal from ancestors having different structural and functional organization is called evolution. So, this is a definition of evolution, or what is a theory? It is a kind of a mechanism. So, what is a mechanism? A progressive development of plant and animal from ancestor, like from old people. So, if there is a development in plant as well, like from one cell to a multi-complex cell or millions of cells, like a human being, like small chlorella to a banyan tree. So, it's a progressive development. It is development which is giving progress. If it is not giving progress, that is not a progressive development. सो फ्रॉम एंसेस्टर, फ्रॉम आवर एंसेस्टर, हमारे पूर्वज, यू मे अंडरस्टैंड पूर्वज. सो वी हैव गॉट प्रोग्रेसिव डेवलपमेंट फ्रॉम आवर एंसेस्टर्स हैविंग अ डिफरेंट स्ट्रक्चरल एंड फंक्शनल. सो इवन स्ट्रक्चर इज बेटर एंड फंक्शन इज ऑल्सो बेटर बिकॉज वी नो बेटर, वी नो मच बेटर देन आवर पेरेंट. And our parent, they knew much better than our grandparents. So whatever we know, like whatever our children will understand, that will be much better than us. So it is a progressive development, and this is a progressive development from ancestor in animal and plant, in what structure and functional organization is called evolution. I hope you understood. The first living material is like protoplasm formed in the ocean. So we are trying to explain how this evolution occurred, and we know that it is a progressive development. So the first living material such as protoplasm, which is formed in the ocean, and further changes from simple unicellular animal to a large, more complex organism, and gradually it took about 300 crores years, means 3 billion years. So from single cellular animal to a multiple cellular organism or complex organism, it took 300 crores of years to form. So the overall process, what we have discussed earlier, from development from single to multicellular and complex animal, there is a changes in the structural and functional organization, is all overall process is called evolution. Now how this evolution has been defined, how we know that this is that evolution has occurred. So we have got different methodology, different criterias to understand how this evolution could have occurred. So we have got an evidence of the evolution. So what is the evidence? There are different kind of evidences available, and the first is morphological evidence, then anatomical evidence, then vestigial organs which we see now is also an evidence for evolution, then paleontological evidence, then connective links and embryological evidence. So these are about six types of evidences which are being discussed in particular this standard, although we have many other part, but it is in detail, it is not going to be discussed at this level. So we will discuss one by one, what is morphological evidence, what is anatomical, what is vestigial, what is paleontological, what is connective link, and what is embryological evidences, which gives a clue by which we have evolved. So let's go to the next part, and the first part is morphological evidence. Now you can see here, you can see the picture, and it's very easily you can understand. In animals, a similarity of structure of mouth, you can see the similarity of the structure of this particular dog, this particular sheep, and this is wolf. So you have three different animals, but there is a similarity. What is the similarity? Structure of mouth. You can see position of mouth, position of eyes, and then nostrils. You can see the nose here, here, and here, and then ear. You can see the ear, although it is down, it's being downwards, but the ear is similar. Then hair on the body. So these are the evidence which are called as a morphological evidence, and you can find in animals. So whether it is a dog, whether it is a sheep, whether it is a wolf, they will have a similar characters of mouth, position of eyes, nostrils, ear, hair on the body. Now you can, if you go to the plant, you can see the leaf shape. Shape of the leaves are similar, but the fruit is different. Then venation in the leaf. Venation is like having the network of the like xylem, phloem, the through which all these nutrients, they go from one side to another side and one part to another part. You can see the leaf here and leaf here, although these three are different plants. Then venation, then position, you can see the position also, position of leaf, fruit, and venation. And then it is suggested that these three different fruits, three different plants are originated from the same ancestor. Like the parents, grandparents, like if you consider that way, they are originated from the same ancestors, like these three. I hope you got my point. let us go to the next type of evidence. Now, anatomical evidence. Now, this is an structure which can be taken through X-ray, and you can see the evidence observed in the structure and shape of the bones. Evidence observed in the structure and shape of the bones and bony joints. You can see the joints here. This is a joint. You can see the joints here. Okay. In hand of human, this is a human hand. Foreleg of cat, you can see the similarity. Then flipper of whale, you can see the whale. This is a flipper. It displaces the water. Then pentagon of bat. Now you can see the bat, the way it moves in the night. It has got webs also, so that through which it displaces the air. Now you see the bony joints. These are all bony joints. You can see here there is a lot of similarity, and they are all different animals and different category. Now they have been involved. So human is the latest animal which is evolved. Okay. So you can see there is a similarity. That's what we call structure of bones, and this is also an evidence which shows that we have evolved from our ancestor. I hope it is clear to you. Now, we'll go to the next type of evidence, such as vestigial organs. Now, first of all, we should know what is vestigial organ. The vestigial organs are, degenerated or underdeveloped or useless in organism, which is not useful. Useless means which is not being used for any purpose. So the organs which are degenerated, it is degenerated in the human being, or it is degenerated in any kind of animal. So degenerated, number one, or it is underdeveloped. Whether it is degeneration means might have earlier in a different shape, it has reduced slowly. Degeneration. There is no regeneration. Generation is not there. Then underdeveloped. It is not developed completely, or it is useless. Useless means it is not having any utilization in the body of body or any animal. It's called vestigial organ. Now you can see the example. The result of a gradual change in the specific characters in the body, useful under certain conditions. Okay. Result of gradual change. So, when the animal is evolving, when the evolution is being occurred, there is an evolution. So, there is a gradual change in a specific characters in a particular body or particular organ. So, if that is useful under certain condition, it may be useful under certain condition, but it may not be useful under some other condition. Like, you can see the appendix in man. This is the appendix part. It is useless in human. This is not of any use in the human being or animal or human means us. But it is useful in ruminants. Okay. Now, similarly, another example. The muscle ear of pinna. Pinna means ear. Muscle ear of pinna. You can see, you can touch your ear. You will find some useless muscles you have got in the ear, which is not useful in human being. So we don't move our ear. Our ear we do not move. So it is not useful for us, but it is useful in monkeys. So this is also a vestigial organ in human being. So what we feel that we have, monkeys are our ancestors. That means monkeys, they have got muscle ear. We do not have muscle. We have muscle ear, but it is not useful. So we say that we have, our ancestors are monkeys. Then tailbone and wisdom teeth and body hairs. So tailbone also in human being, there is a tailbone. And what is the requirement of tailbone? We do not use at all. The tail, we do not have a tail. Monkeys, they have a tail. Okay. So monkeys, they have got a tail. That means slowly from monkey, there is a chimpanzee, there is a another animal which does not have any tail, but the bone is remained. Even when we develop from those ancestors, the bone remained. It degenerated slowly. The tailbone, which is in the animal, is a long tail, which are reduced into a small part, and that is called tailbone, and which is present in the human being. So that is also a vestigial organ because it has no use in the human being. Then wisdom teeth. Wisdom teeth, you know, you will find people at the age of 30 above, 30, 35 plus, they say that I've got a wisdom teeth. Wisdom teeth. So they get teeth at that moment. But that teeth is not useful because it cannot be used for chewing, it cannot be used for crushing, nothing else. It will come at the end of the teeth row and it is cannot be utilized. So that means it is also a vestigial organ. Since our ancestors, they had that particular teeth because it was being utilized. But now it is not being utilized in human being. Similarly, the body hairs, even human being, they have got body hairs. We do not need body hair. It was there in the monkeys, it was there in the other advanced monkeys, but since we do not use, it's of no use, hair is of no use, but we still get hair and we remove it because we don't need it. Animals, they need it because they live in the forest, they live in outside, so it protects the body or it protects the animal, they require hair, body hair, but we do not require. So this is also called as a vestigial organ. So these examples, they tell us that we have been involved from our ancestor. So there is a part of evolvement. Evolvement means advancement, and that advancement in the form of these organs is called evolution. So this is a vestigial organ through which we can say that we have been evolved from our old ancestors. Now the next evidence is paleontological evidence. Now this is a paleontological evidence. You might be surprised, or you may have not gone through this particular type of word, or maybe if you have read the book, you might have understood what is paleontological. So paleontological is a really good evidence through which we study that how long we were there, how long the plants and animals are formed. So this is the evidence which is very important also. And what happens in this case is, like, due to various disasters such as floods, such as eruption of volcanoes, in areas where volcanoes are there, the organism lived on the earth buried alive. So what happens due to the disaster, maybe flood also, maybe eruption of volcanoes, various organisms such as human being or animal or plant or anything can be buried underground, and so the impression of such organism, since they are buried millions of years ago, so you won't get anything. The body will be totally decomposed, but you will find the impression of that particular animal in the rocks. So they are preserved underground, and these are called fossils. The study of fossil is important for the study of evolution because this is very important. And an animal which is very difficult to get, like whatever you see in the film, like dinosaur, we have not seen a dinosaur, but we really still find the dinosaur's eggs as a fossil. We still find a dinosaur bones in the form of fossil. They are all fossilized. Fossilization occurs. So, and this can be calculated. The age of that fossil can be calculated. When this particular animal was long time back. The calculation of that living animal can be done by using carbon. And all living animal consume carbon through food source and plant, for which it requires, and they synthesize its food. So the plant they consume, or they synthesize the food, it has a carbon. We also consume the food, we get the carbon. So the carbon, there are different types of carbons, where carbon the element, and the carbon is C, that is a symbol of carbon. It has got sometimes 12, C12, and sometimes C14, and it remains the same. So what remains the same? The ratio of carbon 12 and C14 remains the same in living organism. So living organism is any kind of organism, whether it is a plant, whether it is animal, the ratio of C12 and C14. So what is C12? C12 is a molecular weight. So what is the molecular weight? Molecular weight of that particular carbon is proton, number of protons are 6 and number of neutrons are 6. So they are 6. And since the number of protons are 6, the number of electrons will be 6 and they will be rotating around the carbon nucleus. Okay. So that is C12. So when that C12 turns into C14, that is radioactive. And since it has got proton 6, but number of neutrons increases and that number becomes 8. So then it becomes C14. So in the living organism, we have got radioactive C14 and non-radioactive C12. So the ratio, the amount of C12 and C14 is constant in the living organism. But after the death of the living process, the process stops. Process stops means metabolic activity stops. We cannot breathe. We are dead. So you don't breathe. So if you don't breathe, there is no oxygen going in and there is no carbon dioxide coming out. So whatever is in the body, it remains as it is. So C14, which is radioactive, it starts decaying. So since it is a radioactive, it will not stay, it is not stable. And since it is not a stable, it will start decomposing or decaying constantly. Hence the ratio of amount of C12 and C14 will change with time. So slowly amount of C14 will reduce. Okay. So the half life of C14 is about 5730 years. So suppose there is a C14 amount is 1 gram, to change into 0.5 gram, it will take 5730 years. It means the amount of C14 present in the living organism reduced to half. So this is a half life of C14. So the ratio between C12 and C14 changes, and that shows the life of that particular fossil or life of that particular animal or plant when it must have been fossilized or maybe buried. So reduction of C14 amount results in the changes of ratio of C12 and C14, and by calculating the rate of change. So when the amount is fixed, ratio is fixed in living being. So if the rate, you can calculate, you know the rate through which it changes. So it takes 5730 years. So by this rate of the ratio is used to calculate the age of the fossil. And this method is called carbon dating. I hope you understood. So you can let us go through again. The reduction of C12 amount results in change in the ratio of C12 and C14. And by calculating the rate of change, like change in the amount of C14, rate of change in the amount of C14, the ratio is used to calculate the age of the fossil, and this method is called carbon dating. Okay. So carbon dating method is used to calculate the age of fossil, which is proposed by Willard Libby, and for this he was awarded Nobel Prize in 1960. So he is the person. Willard Libby has described how we can calculate the ratio of C12 and C14 in the living and in the non-living organism, so that you can calculate the age of the fossil. And this is the method which is called carbon dating. Okay, I hope you got the point. And if there is any query, anything, you can write on the mail. I'll receive it, I'll reply. Okay, so the next is connecting links. Now, link between two things. Some plants and animals show few morphological characters. You can go through the line. It explains very easily. Show few morphological characters by which they can be related to two different groups. of animals, hence they are called collectilings. I hope you got the definition here. So the explanation is, if you see two things and if you think that these things are different, so you may get some thing which is in between, which you show the character of the other one and this one, the previous one and the fresh one and the new one. So you can relate, you can correlate that ye upar se bhi hai. Or see how we can, how we check, like a person who has got character from father as well as son. So son will have a character of father and father will character of a grandma. Now you can see the way I have explained that morphological characters, through morphological characters, yeah, you have seen the mouth, you have seen the position of eyes, you have seen the type of ear, and you have seen the faces. So you have correlated that they might have come from the ancestor. Similarly here, you can correlate between two different phylums, two different groups. These groups are, for example, I can explain to you here as a peripatus. Peripatus is an animal which show the segmented body. Body is segmented, means it has got lining. How many segments are present in the peripatus? And then it has got a thin cuticle. Cuticle means a skin. It is called a cuticle because it belongs to an arthropod group, belongs to between the arthropod and annelid group. So it has got a thin cuticle, then parapoda like organ found in annelids. It also show tracheal respiration. So that means it has got segmented body, it has got thin cuticle is very thin, not very hard. Then parapoda like organ, parapoda means not completely developed eggs, but it has got prolegs, which is not even leg, and it is without leg also. So it is got proleg. Okay, so it is called parapoda like organ. I'll show you the picture and then you understand. And found in annelids, which is found in the annelida. You must have known the group annelida, where there is a earthworm, there is a tapeworm. These are all comes in that group. And the same animal, peripatus, also has tracheal respiration. Tracheal respiration is a characteristics of insects. And it has got open circulatory system like arthropod. So arthropod means insect. Insect belong to arthropod. So it is a link between annelid and arthropod. It has got a character of annelid group as well as arthropod group. And this suggests that peripatus is a connecting link between annelid and arthropod. I hope you clear. You are clear now. Now there is another animal which is called duck-billed platypus. Duck-billed platypus, it lays eggs. And what is the character of for laying egg? It is a character of reptile. So it is reptile but has got a mammary gland and body hair. And mammary gland and body hair is a character of mammal. So that means it is a link between reptile and mammals. So these are the animals which show to us that they have got a link. That means we have developed from a different group onwards through evolution process. Now there is a fish which also a lungfish, which has a lung for respiration, and lung is required for respiration. Lung is required for amphibia. Okay, lungs, it is respiration is done by amphibia, in the amphibian group. So it is a fish. Fish never breathes with the lung, it breathes with the gill. This fish does not have a gill, it has got a lung. So lung is a character of amphibia. Amphibia are like frogs. I hope you have got, you understood. Amphibia, it is a frog, but fish is a Pisces group. So Pisces is a previous primitive group and amphibians are advanced group. So it is a characteristics between fish and amphibia means frog. So that means a lung is there in the fish, which is a different. So these are the connecting links. And those links, you can see in the note, you can see in the book, and you will see the different characters of three on the page number 6.
you can observe and discuss. These are connecting links. So you'll see lungfish as well as duck-billed platypus as well as peripatus.
So that picture I have missed here. So you can see in the book also, and you can write notes on that. Okay, the next is embryological evidence. See, you can see the embryology. Embryological evidence means when the baby is a small, embryology, they are in the embryo, they are in the womb. So they develop, we cannot see them because it is inside. And since they are inside, it is very difficult to see from outside. But if you see the characters, now comparative morphological study of embryo, comparative morphology. Comparative means comparison between morphological characters of embryos. Of what? Various groups. Various groups means we are talking about Pisces, we are talking about amphibians, we are talking about reptilians, we are talking about apes, we are talking about mammals. So these are the groups of vertebrates. Okay. So when we compare fish, amphibia, reptile, birds and mammals, you can see the extreme similarities. You can see the similarities between the embryos. How they, when they were small, they look similar. But when they grow, they look different morphologically. So you can see the initial stage. So you can see the fish here. So this is the initial stage of fish. This is initial stage of reptile. Salamander. Salamander is it is an amphibian. And this is tortoise, which is reptile. And this is chicken, which is a bird. This is a pig, which is a mammal. This is a cow, which is also a mammal. And this is a rabbit, which is also a mammal. And this is a man, human being, which is us. So you can see, they look similar. The first stage of these all three, all group, like fishes, amphibians, reptilians, chicken, means birds, and mammals. They look similar. There you can see the second here. Second stage, they are different. They are slightly changing from initial stage to the next stage. Now you can see the changes like man here. You can see the changes in the fish. So slowly the characters, morphological characters changes. But initially they look similar. So that means this is the evidence. This is the evidence of embryology, which shows that we have developed from the, slowly we have developed from the primitive groups. So that's why it's extreme similarities during initial stages of development indicate that the common origin of all these animals. That means we have all originated from a common ancestor even before. Okay. I hope you have understood, and I hope you have you can remember the evidences what we have discussed of evolution. Now, maybe if you have any query and anything, you can ask on the email, or you can ask the WhatsApp group of ma'am, and then I will explain to you. So based on the evolution, based on the development, there are different areas, different era have been designed, and the different eras are like Reptilia, Amphibia and Pisces. They are like in a different era, Paleozoic era, then Mesozoic era, then Cenozoic era. In Cenozoic era, you will find birds and rabbits. In Mesozoic era, you will find reptiles, all reptiles, most of them. And then Paleozoic era, you will find reptiles and also reptile, as well as amphibia and fishes. And then at the later stage or bottom of the particular Paleozoic era, you will find all the invertebrates, right from unicellular animal up to the starfish or even shells, which you find in the seas, or you find earthworm, anything. So invertebrates, then you got it, vertebrates. Vertebrates are Pisces, amphibians and onwards. So I hope I have clarified this particular aspect of evolution, where we have discussed evolution part, and that evolution has covered evolution through six examples or six evidences we have discussed. Now we will see, we will go to the next stage, and that will be a theory, and what we have theory earlier proposed. So these are the evidences and the theories we will discuss later on. So I hope I have clarified, and I hope you go through the notebook, go through the book, write the notes. If you have got any difficulty, again I say that you please write to ma'am, so I'll come to know. Okay, thank you very much. See you in the next session.